So since today is a celebration day, these next songs are very much focused on the celebration of resurrection, of what Jesus Christ has done. Feel free to clap, feel free to dance around if you like to. This is a day to celebrate if there's any day to do it.
Oh, Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth.
I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church.
I believe in the resurrection
when Jesus comes again.
I believe in Christ the Son.
I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
For there is one God and one mediator who can reconcile God and humanity, the man Christ Jesus. He gave his life to purchase freedom for everyone.
So never be ashamed to tell others about our Lord, for God saved us and called us to live a holy life. He did this not because we deserved it, but because that was his plan from the beginning of time, to show us his grace through Christ Jesus. And now he has made all of this plain to us by the appearing of Christ Jesus, our Savior. He broke the power of death and illuminated the way to life and immortality through the good news. Always remember that Jesus Christ, a descendant of King David, was raised from the dead. This is the good news I preach.
Christ was revealed in a human body and vindicated by the Spirit. He was seen by angels and announced to the nations. He was believed in throughout the world and taken to heaven in glory. Hold tightly to the eternal life to which God has called you, which you have declared so well before many witnesses. And I charge you before God, who gives life to all, and before Christ Jesus, who gave a good testimony before Pontius Pilate, that you obey this command without wavering. Then no one can find fault with you from now until our Lord Jesus Christ comes again. For at just the right time, Christ will be revealed from heaven by the blessed and only Almighty God, the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. He alone can never die, and he lives in light so brilliant that no human can approach him. All honor and power to him forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Easter is a great day to get to celebrate together. I'm so glad that you have chosen to be here with us. One of the things that I've been saying over and over throughout this year is that as a church, we want to raise people up and inspire people. And that word inspire, it comes from breathing life, breathe new life. And Easter, resurrection, is all about raising up this new life, this new breath. And so today, as we talk about that, keep those things in the back of your mind. At Damascus Road, we believe that church is about relationships. It's about family. It's not just something you do by yourself, but it's us together. And it is about faith and all of these. And so we've been looking at this sort of faith-training relationship between two men in the Bible. One of them is the Apostle Paul, and one is Timothy, a man that he was training. And looking at the two of them and how that was affecting their lives. And so I want to look at them, but from the aspect of resurrection. of what resurrection meant in their lives, what it meant to them as individuals, what it meant to them as they worked together, to see a little bit what that means for us. What is resurrection supposed to look like in our lives? But maybe before I get to that, I should say the story that this is all based upon with Jesus. I'm sure many people here today, you've heard it, you at least know it to a degree, but you heard some of that in that reading. There was Jesus sent from God, the Son of God, who lived on this earth and lived a perfect life, who lived showing us exactly what God is like. He was the image of the invisible God, showing us God's character, God's love, God's power, His miracles. Jesus came to be the King, showing what God's kingdom was meant to be like. But there are other people who are concerned about their own little kingdoms. And so even though God had foreknew it, these people who were against Jesus conspired to have him killed, and he was crucified as a criminal. Because evil thinks that it can destroy the Son of God through death. But that was the means towards the greatest victory that the world has ever seen and ever known. Because on a Sunday morning, when a group of his friends, women, had gone out to the tomb to find his body because they thought he would still be dead and they would anoint him, instead, they found a tomb that was empty, except for grave clothes that had no body in it anymore. And the angels announcing to them, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's not here. He's alive." And then over the next 40-some days or so, more than 500 witnesses saw Jesus resurrected. A real, living person. That resurrection wasn't just some kind of nice, "Oh, I've seen a ghost." It was, "I've seen a real body that I can touch, a real person that can speak to me, who is alive from the dead, so that even the worst enemy, death, could not beat him. And now he is enthroned as king above all, with power over sin and death." That's the story that this is all based around. See, this man, Paul, he didn't grow up following the way of Jesus, or even liking the idea of Jesus. When he had first heard about Jesus and this whole story, he thought that it was a dangerous lie from the pit of hell. It's probably the best way it can be put. And Paul did whatever he could to stop this news about Jesus from spreading, because he thought Jesus was just a dead man who had been a false teacher that had misled people, and now we thought he's dead and that will be easy, but people are saying he's alive, and it keeps spreading and spreading, and more people are running after these lies. That's what he thought. And so he stood there when the first man to be killed in the name of Jesus, his name was Stephen, he was a martyr, and Paul was standing there saying, "Yep, I agree to him being stoned to death." And after that, that seemed to just unleash more people, where he went around finding Christians, having them killed or persecuted, and not just in the city he was from, but he got the official orders from other leaders to go to other cities so that he could find Christians, men and women, going door to door and dragging these people who followed Jesus back to Jerusalem so that they could be tortured until they gave up this whole Jesus delusion. And one of those times he was traveling to the city of Damascus to try to do the same thing there. But as he's going towards Damascus, this bright, shining light knocks him off of his horse. And he hears a voice that calls his name and says, "Why are you persecuting me? Who are you?" Because Paul has been blinded, he can't see, he doesn't recognize the voice. "Who are you?" "I'm Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city and you'll be told what to do." And that begins this incredible change in Paul's life. That moment of Jesus speaking to him on the road. And if you read through sort of the storyline of what happened after Jesus' resurrection, in the Bible, it's in the book of Acts. Paul tells this story over and over. When he gets the opportunity, he tells his story. I hated Jesus, everything he stood for, but then there came this moment when I was on this road to Damascus that Jesus showed up to me and spoke to me. And now I see that instead of Jesus being the enemy, Jesus is the great victor. Now put this again in relationship. Paul teaches this everywhere he goes, and Timothy was this man younger than he was that had been traveling with him for more than a decade, it seems, in total. Timothy heard this over and over and over and saw what a change the resurrection of Jesus had made in the life of Paul. As I said earlier, Jesus couldn't have just been a ghost that showed up, because Paul is a good Jewish man. Would not have accepted that as okay. Talking to the dead, talking to a ghost, would have still been something he hated. It was against God's law to try to speak to the dead. If Jesus is just a voice from beyond the grave speaking to him, that would not have convinced Paul to change his life. Paul had to be speaking to a living person, a resurrected Jesus, for him to say that is something I will follow. And so that meeting with a resurrection person changed so much of Paul's idea on what God was like, on who God cared about, what was the story he was telling, on morals and values and what to value in your life. And so as Paul teaches, we heard some of the things he had taught Timothy, and there are three kind of big passages I just want to look at quick. This is the message that Paul says, this is what I got. This is the good news. One of the things he says is that there's only one God and one mediator between God and man, the man, Jesus Christ, who purchased us for God by his death. Jesus had really died. The second thing that he tells us is that Jesus has overcome the grave, has defeated death. When he tells Timothy, you should follow with the good news, he gets around to telling him that not only has Jesus purchased freedom for everyone, but that Jesus has also overcome death and the grave. Jesus, our Savior, broke the power of death and illuminated the way to life. That picture of light kept coming up. Because what's the first time that he saw Jesus? A big, blinding light. And then the third thing that he kept teaching Timothy over and over says, remember, Jesus descended from King David, raised from the dead. This is the good news that I'm teaching. Now, for some of us, the descendant from King David, what does that have to do with it? Where does that fit into the equation? But for the people that Paul would be talking to, especially to Timothy, as he's writing it to this young man, Timothy understands the whole story behind it. King David is this great character in their culture. So one saying he's descended from King David means that Jesus has the blood right to be a king. He's royalty. And that's something that gets stressed over and over. Jesus is the king. When we say the term Jesus Christ, Christ isn't actually Jesus' last name. I mean, we're kind of used to that. Like, if he was going to fill out paper, Jesus, last name, Christ. But that's not. Christ is a title that means anointed one. The people that you anointed at that time seems like a very strong allusion to a king. Jesus, the king. So Jesus the priest, but especially to focus on the king part. Jesus the king. He has the right to be king because he's descended from King David. So that's part of it. Jesus has the right to be a king, but not just that. Paul is trying to put is in the whole realm of what God has been doing. And so Timothy, as he's hearing about King David, he knows King David fits into this story of how God has chosen a people, about how God has made promises to them, how he's been working throughout it, and how God wants to set up his kingdom for all nations all over the earth. And doing that, saying, descended from King David, says, Jesus is part of what God has been trying to do this whole time. That's what he wanted. And so, he says, remember that. Jesus, who's descended from King David, this is what God has been doing. Which Paul hadn't realized before, until he saw the resurrected Jesus. He said, before, I thought Jesus was totally off of God's plan. But if you remember, Jesus descended from King David, who was raised from the dead. I see that Jesus was right in the middle. That's what God was wanting to do this whole time. Remember that, because that is the good news I'm sharing. So that's one of the times in his life where resurrection really would have affected Paul and that interaction with Timothy. But I want to talk about three more other pictures, so that we have these four kind of pictures together. One, the resurrection changes Paul's idea about God. But because Jesus had raised from the dead, resurrection changed Paul's view on death to where he no longer had to be afraid of death. Timothy grew up in a city called Lystra. And the first time, as far as we know, that Paul ever visits Lystra, he's sharing this good news about Jesus. But as he goes around, not long, there's a riot that gets mad at Paul, stones him, and drags him out of the city thinking that he's dead. And they walk away. And then all these people who have listened to Paul's message, they've started to believe, they come around Paul. And we're told that when the believers came around him, Paul just stood up and walked right back to the city. Now that may not have been a resurrection, because we're not told he actually did die, they just thought he was dead. But Paul has been beaten within an inch of his life. But the resurrection of Jesus means that he doesn't have to be afraid of death anymore. Trying to kill me, fine. Then I get back up and I will walk right back into the same city. Still telling people about Jesus. Paul didn't have to fear death, and so he didn't have to fear taking the message anywhere, because there was no place that was too far for that message to go. He would put in all of his life into it. Because there's no fear of death anymore. The resurrection of Jesus, who has conquered death and illuminated the way to life. And that's the city where Timothy grew up. Timothy knew that story. When Paul said, hey, Timothy, would you travel with me? We got to take this message around. Timothy would know what that meant. Timothy knew that this is a man who truly believes in resurrection to the point that he's willing to die for it. That's what I'm saying yes to. So how big of a change that was. So that's the second time where I see resurrection involved with Paul and Timothy's relationship. There's even a third one. So about a decade after they've been traveling together, we're told that Paul was going on his way towards Jerusalem, but he stopped in a place called Troas. He was there for a week with some of the other men that were with him. And one of those is Timothy. And on the first day of the week, on the Sunday, Paul is teaching. And Paul's a guy who's able to talk for long periods of time. Hopefully I haven't taken so long and bored you yet that you fall asleep. But it sounds like Paul, he's just preaching for hours and hours while people are listening. But the problem is there's a young man who's sitting in a windowsill. And he falls asleep. And then falls out of a third-story window to his death. That would break up the church meeting pretty quick, right? I actually have heard of people dying in a church meeting, but especially like they fell asleep and dead. It would be a really sad, bad story. But then Paul, while Timothy's there, Paul goes downstairs. We're told that he goes to the young man Eutychus, takes him in his arms, and he follows this pattern of what we've actually seen at other times in the New Testament and Old Testament, Bartoli takes the boy in his arms, and he just turns to everyone and says, "It's okay. He's alive." Goes back upstairs. And it's like Paul was in the middle of a sermon. He's like, "I'm not done yet, guys. Come on. We're going to keep preaching tonight." And we're told that the young man was taken home alive and well. And everyone was greatly relieved. That would be, you know, it's like, "I'm loving the sermon. Oh my goodness, someone's dead. Okay, he's alive." Dodged the bullet on that one. No one's getting sued today. Let's get you home. You need to go to bed now. Resurrection changed the way that Paul interacted with people. It wasn't just words. It wasn't just, "Hey, I've got this great story for you." But Paul would say there is power in the resurrection of Jesus. And because he is king and I am sent under his authority, there is power in me. And so when he writes to the city of Ephesus, which is another big city that's important in the story of Timothy and Paul, when he wrote to Ephesus, he said, I pray that you might know the incomparably great power for us that believe. Same power that raised Christ from the dead. Paul really believed that the resurrection of Jesus wasn't just, "Well, that's great, Jesus is powerful. Well, that's going to turn out well for the rest of us." He believed that that resurrection of Jesus meant that there was also power that was given through Jesus as king to his people to go live out his kingdom. Resurrection is not just something to celebrate one day. Great, we had a celebration. But it's meant for it to be lived out. And Timothy saw that in Paul's life. Even to the point of a literal resurrection of a young man from the dead. That still happens. And I've seen miracles in my life. I have not personally seen someone raised from the dead, but I know a guy who knows a guy. Actually, several. Like, it still happens today. That's not just something from, "Oh, well, that was good 2,000 years ago." But that same power, still. Because Jesus raising from the dead, even though other people had raised from the dead in history, even throughout Jewish history, there was something different about Jesus's. It wasn't just, "Oh, well, he came back." It wasn't just, "Well, some prophet comes and raises Jesus from the dead." No. This was the Jesus who had prophesied about himself. He's the prophet. "I will die, but I will be raised again. My God the Father, through the Holy Spirit, I will take up my life again." And that showed that Jesus was king. So that's the third picture. I'll give you a fourth. That Timothy, it wasn't just a moment in time, but it was an arc of seeing it. One of the places that Paul sent Timothy off to was a place called Thessaloniki, still around today. And when Timothy came back and was telling Paul, "This is what's happening in the city, this is what's going well, this is what's not going well." And then Paul and Timothy write this letter together, 1 Thessalonians. They write this letter that gets sent off. And one of the things that Paul talks about to those people is about a resurrection that's a day yet to come. Not just the resurrection of Jesus, not just the ability to raise people from the dead like we saw with Eutychus, but he's saying there will be a day of resurrection that will come. And when it does, Jesus will come down with a loud command, with a loud voice, with the sound of trumpets. And these are all meant to be pictures of what it was like when a king was entering a city. So he's saying when Jesus comes, he's coming as a king. And there's shouts and commands and there's trumpets. Jesus, when he comes to the place, when he comes to a city, the dead in Christ will rise first. There will be a resurrection for those that have believed. And then we who are still alive, we will also be raised up with them, and together we will go to Jesus and we'll be with him forever. And this is the one that probably struck me the most. Because Paul is writing this within about 20, 30 years after Jesus have risen from the dead. So when he's talking about those people that have died in Christ, who is Paul talking about? Well, there's probably some that had sort of died from natural causes in those 20, 30 years. There have been some of those, yes. But for the most part, the people who had died were those that had been persecuted. And some of those were people that Paul had as acquaintances or as friends. Of the original 12 disciples that followed Jesus, only one of them died a natural death, from what we know. So many of these had died and he'd had that. But that wasn't just after Paul had decided to follow Jesus. See, some of those people that Paul was going to get to see were people that the last time Paul saw them was when he was dragging them out of their houses. When he was destroying their lives. When he was destroying their families. When he was trying to destroy everything that Jesus had done. And Paul, when he's writing that, Timothy's there. The two of them are writing it together. And Timothy knows these stories. He's heard Paul talk about it over and over. And when Paul is saying the dead in Christ are going to rise first. And we're going to get to be with them. All of these things, all of the past, all of the junk that Paul had made with his hate, with his own self-righteousness, with his own self-servingness, the I know better than everyone else, all that he had left in his wake, resurrection was going to be able to put a new spin on all of that. And even the people that he killed, even his past, not just the present of Jesus has shown up to me and that has changed my present resurrection. And not just the future plans of what he was doing and how he was working, but even his past was going to be affected by the resurrection. And these other people were going to rise up. And then Paul together with them, instead of fighting them together, they were going to go together to their King Jesus. And that was probably a pretty amazing thought for him. To be able to say, he probably wasn't even going to get to say, no, I'm sorry. I was wrong. Because everyone would be too busy going to the king that was coming to them. The ones that had died waiting on Jesus Christ. The ones that had died saying, I won't let anything get in my way. Then when Jesus is calling them with a loud voice and with a trumpet, they're going to be like, Paul, I don't have time for you. I got something better. But together, they rise and welcome Jesus and be with him. That's the kind of power that resurrection had. And so as Paul shared all those things, I think Timothy was watching and hearing and learning that resurrection isn't just something to wait for the future, but resurrection is something meant to be in our lives now. Changing who we are, changing what we value. Because if Jesus really is a king, that whole picture of a kingdom means if you're buying into that, that means he has the right to be your king. He has the right to say how it works. And he's a good king who wants to bring life and light. He's worth following. But you have to make that decision to follow him with your life. And if you really believe in his resurrection, then to follow him even to death isn't something you have to be afraid of. Because resurrection means that he has broken the power of death and given us the way towards life. We're going to have a drama dance here in a moment that tries to help show a bit of what that is like. So as they get ready to do that, the music will start in a moment. I hope that as you watch it, by the end that you'll be celebrating. That you'll see the power of what Jesus can do. Not just in his death, but in his resurrection as well. So please.
Has a story to tell. Each of us has a story to tell. A story that can change the lives of people all around us forever.
This is our story.
Lost.
Confused.
Hopeless.
Helpless.
Restless.
Depressed.
Demented.
In despair.
Suicidal.
Weak.
Brokenhearted.
My academics was suffering.
My career was a mess.
I was rejected by my family.
I shook with the shame.
I hated my parents, especially my dad.
I knew I needed help.
Still, I tried to cover it all up, but it was
useless.
I took out my pain on everyone around.
I was enraged.
Guilt and condemnation tore my soul.
Who can help me?
Help! I screamed from within.
But no one could hear me, let alone save me.
Words. Words fail me to express the horrors of hell I experienced.
I was so close to death.
Look, this was my life.
I'm free.
today. My life changed.
I couldn't believe that I was finally free.
It was like a huge weight was lifted off my shoulders.
I haven't been the same since that day.
See? That's our story. And your story can change also.
May you have a life-changing and transforming experience as we have.
The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ has brought us into freedom in God.
Now, we may come boldly before God's throne of grace to obtain mercy and find help in times of need.
And His love for us is calling all of us into a special relationship with the Father.
Now, we may enter His presence with joy.
There might be people here who haven't gotten to that celebration part yet at the end of the story. And that can be part of what changes in your life today. You came to an Easter celebration. My hope is that by the time you leave, you will find freedom in Jesus Christ that allows you to celebrate as well. I want to ask the band to come forward, and we'll just do a few songs at the end. But if you want to have someone pray with you, we're going to have some of our servant leaders, as well as some of the care team people would be willing to help as well. And they'll just sort of be up here in this corner, a little off to the side. And while we sing, if you want someone to pray with you, that could be for any sort of thing. Maybe you are feeling some of the, I feel anxiety, I feel fear, maybe the fear of death. Maybe you don't know what to make of Jesus, and you want to just talk to someone a little bit about it. You say, I want I want that freedom and I want someone to pray with me. Do you come for that? If it is physical healing or something like that, where you want someone to pray with you, know that there will be those here just on the side, and you can go and pray with them while we sing. But let's take a moment to pray going into that. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you are a God of celebration. And so often when Jesus told stories about you and your kingdom, there was the Father, the King, who was having a banquet, who was throwing a party, who was having a celebration. That's in your heart, that's in your character. And I pray that we would enter with open arms today. I pray that if there are people that feel like they've been running away for a long time and they're not sure if they're invited to that party that you're trying to throw, that they would be like a prodigal son or daughter that comes home and finds that you are running out to them with arms wide open, wanting to invite them in today, wanting to welcome them to the celebration that you've prepared. So God, may people take those first steps towards you and find that you are running with love toward them. Pray that people would be set free in the authority that's now in the risen Jesus Christ. It's in his authority we pray. Amen.
Amen.